That is so good. I have the honor of introducing someone that has been so incredibly special to me for a long time in my life. And I don't know how long I've known you, Pastor Mark, but has it been 20 years? Just about 20 years. And I first started liking him when he gave me a really expensive guitar. And he told me that I was going to lead worship. And at that time in my life, I had other dreams. I had other things that I wanted to do in my life and other plans that I felt that God was doing. And being in a band and being a rock star and living the dream. And little did I know that he was sowing a seed into my life that would change my life forever. And ever since that moment, what God has been doing with that seed in my life and what God has been planting, and then what God continued to develop out of the relationship that I have with Pastor Mark Evans, it's been incredible that he just went from being a guy that I liked because the Southern accent really sucks me in. You know, I just have a thing for accents. But really, he's honestly been like a dad to me. And he has spoken into my life so many times. Sorry, I'm stuck in that moment of greater you, Lord. Woo! You are too. It was good. So good. Wow, so good. But there's been so many times. So I turned some 40 now. And he has been there through so many things. And things that the ups and downs in my life and everything that I've gone through, and that he has showed me nothing but love, and he showed me what Jesus looks like. He has shown me wisdom. He has shown me guidance. He showed so many things. And my life has never been the same ever since Pastor Mark came into my life. So I knew when we had the opportunity of putting on this youth conference and things weren't really working out the way that we thought they were going to work out. You know, when you name a conference Holy Disruption, you know, you put the name Disruption in there, like you can really expect. I was talking to Pastor Rob and it's like, and he's like, everything that like I was planning with this, it's completely different. And it's like, yeah, well, you put the name Disruption in the name of your conference. So of course it's going to get disrupted. And when we had this opportunity of like, okay, where are we going to go? What are we going to do? No doubt, Holy Spirit laid on our hearts that we're going to give Pastor Mark a call, and we're going to see if he's available to come up the whole way from the Atlanta, Georgia area, and he brought the heat with him. When I picked him up at the airport, I'm like, hey, so what's the weather like down there? And he's like, it's like in the 90s normally. I'm like, so you're used to this. You're crazy. But it's so good. So he's used to it. But one thing that he's also used to is knowing the heart of the Father. So I know tonight, as he makes his way up here, I don't know what happened to the other microphone or if I'm going to hand him this one. But I just know that tonight you're going to see and hear the heart of the Father. And I know if you keep your heart open, your life will never be the same tonight. What God wants to do in and through Pastor Mark is exactly what God has wanted to do in this conference before we even thought of a conference. God had this night and this weekend ordained and had you ordained to be here in this moment so that your life could be changed forever. So I know the word that he's going to bring forth is not only going to change your life, it's going to change my life. And if we move forward with it, I'm telling you what, your life will never, ever, ever be the same. So without further ado, I want to introduce one of the most special people to me in my life, Pastor Mark Evans.
Do you love Jesus? That's pitiful. Do you love Jesus? One real round of shout of thanks for the praise team. Where's Marie? Is Marie in the room? Where? I can't see. Oh, come here, Marie. You sing really good. All of you, like, incredible. I cried and all. You're wonderful. Listen, you're a good singer. In your future, if dinosaur racing is a thing.
Right.
You say, yes, Lord. If you can use anything, Jesus, don't get sidetracked with worship.
No.
That's good. It touches people. But I watched you dinosaur race. I'm like, I don't even know why you're leading worship. Like, I was like, she's wasting her talents singing about Jesus. And then I prayed about that. I was like, Jesus, and I bowed my head and I said, Jesus. And he said, mm-hmm. And I said, should I say something? And he said, from her mother's belly, I have ordained her to race dinosaurs. So should it become an Olympic sport?
I think so.
You look at your parents and you say, look, college, okay, but dinosaur racing, Jesus wants me to, and I'm saying yes to him.
I get that a lot.
Okay, good. Thank you. Give it up for the dinosaur racer. It was absolutely incredible. Look up here to the $19,000 TV screen. And I've never seen a TV screen like this. I'm going to run through, before I say something about what we're going to talk about, I'm going to just talk to you a little bit about my life so you know me, because I got to hang out with you all day tomorrow. And thank God they said we have to wear t-shirts when we go down the slide, because you don't want to see this without a t-shirt on. Just say. So thank you, whoever made that rule. This is my lovely bride. Her name is Robin with two B's and a Y, and that's me, and a crooked eye and a big forehead, and that hand on there is I don't know, somebody's. And then my next picture, that's my dog Samson. Don't feel sorry for him, he's spirit filled. And this is Samson. He has his own recliner. So he has his own little leather recliner that he sits in and just watches TV, drinks coffee, sheds, eats the couch. And then I have four daughters. I'll show them to you in a minute. I have four girls. I was raised with all girls. You're welcome. I sit down when I go to the bathroom now. You're welcome. And so they trained me well. And so my last daughter graduated high school, and my wife is having a meltdown because there's no more kids in the house, potentially. And so this is the next one, our next child. That's Rooster, a dog named Rooster, but not Rooster like Rooster, but Rooster as in Top Gun. Because my daughter saw Rooster and said, oh my God, Dad, he's hot. And so she named her dog after some hot guy. So now every time the dog, I'm like, Rooster. And I'm like, I feel perverted. So I just tell people he's named after a chicken instead of some hot guy from Hollywood. And this is him too. He gets his little hair up in a bow, and he gets a little bandana he gets to wear. And right there, he's thinking, surely you're going to give me that cookie. And I said, yes. And then I got in trouble. These are my sons, or two of son-in-laws. One on the left is Joey. One on the right is Michael. These are my daughters. Those are my four girls. Youngest in the middle. Redhead is second. My oldest is to the right. And my second child is to the left. These are my four daughters again with their mother. And my girls are addicted to Disney World, I'm sorry, but they like to go to Disney World and give their money to wicked things. And so pray for them, if you will, that they'll get saved. You can see she has tattoos, so she's probably going to hell. I don't know, that's what they told me. And she said, Dad, can I get a tattoo? I said, if you want to go to hell, you can. And she goes, I'm going to risk it. And so I said, okay. And then I got a tattoo because I thought, if she's going, I need to be there to help her. So I'm a good father. So I didn't get tattoos for some special thing. I'm like, if we're going to hell, we're going as a family. So there's that. There they are at Disney again. That's the third and the fourth kid. And they just got back. That's my daughter who just graduated. Her name is Stella. And so last night I called them, and I'm sorry because I asked them. I said, can I wear my blue shoes with my black t-shirt? And they said, no, you cannot do that. You cannot wear a different color shoe, Dad, than your t-shirt, because that'll be embarrassing. And I did it anyway, so there. So take that. So I know I don't match. So if that distracts you and you don't hear anything I say about the Lord, I understand it's probably the shoes not matching with the shirt. But tomorrow night I'll match, and I'll call him in a minute. So this is the two. Oh, I forgot I had grandchildren. So I have two grandgirls. So everybody in my family's girls. I have an inability to produce male species. They're all women. You're welcome, ladies. Her name is Johnny Love. Then I also have this child, grandchild, I should say. That's Johnny Love with Montgomery James. And then I think I got one more. Yep, there's Johnny Love. She's thinking, can I have that cookie? And I want to apologize because I did not know the t-shirt rule, and she doesn't have a t-shirt on. So I'm like, oh my God, I've broken a rule. I'm sorry. I will Photoshop that tomorrow and put a t-shirt on her. But that's little Johnny Love. Her little belly button's so cute there. And she's probably thinking, I know what she's thinking. She's thinking, I should have put a t-shirt on. And I'm like, don't worry, your sisters are going to hell. So they're all okay because they have tattoos. Thank God she doesn't have a tattoo. I don't know. And that's Monty in Panama City last week. We went there to the beach. So I called these two because I'm not saying they're closest, like I like them more than the other two, because I like them all. But these two still live at home. So the one on the left is 25, and she's a nurse, and she lives at home. The one on the right is 18, and she's moving out to go to the University of Alabama in a few months. But they're really close, and so I called them last night or today because I kind of felt weird. I said, oh my God, I'm 60. My shoes don't match. I'm a horrible father because I'm going to let y'all go to hell for tattoos. And I'm talking to him. There's a dad, you're good. It's okay. I said, no, you don't understand. There's this dude here today. I don't know why Nathan called me. And then suddenly I got bitter at Nathan. I'm like, I don't even like Nathan anymore. I want my guitar back. And because I'm like, he's like, oh, we just want you to come, Pastor Mark, because you're so cool. And I'm like, dude, I'm 60. You don't need me to come. Oh, you're going to be there because we got a little guy that's going to paint. And so I'm watching the guy paint today. And I'm like, I got to follow that? I have no talent at all. And I call my wife and my girls. I'm like, I have to follow a dude that painted a portrait of Jesus Christ in the span of two songs. And they're like, oh, that's cool. I said, no, you don't understand. He did it upside down. Like, I'm ADD, and I understand that. He did a painting of Jesus Christ upside down. The whole time he's painting, I'm thinking to myself, I could do that because that's ugly. All he's doing is like... And I'm like, I can do that. I got it. And then he flips it up and it's Jesus. Then I repent, like, oh my God. And I call the girls, like, get rid of your tattoos. Jesus is real. Like, ugh. And so I'm like, I don't know what I'm going to do. So I have zero talent. So I called these girls and I said, I feel stupid. I don't know what I'm going to do. I feel like I got a word from Jesus, but I have no talents. And they said, Dad, you are talented. And I said, no, not like this guy. So I'm going to call one of them. Oh, excuse me. I just broke $5,000 worth of something. I've never been around this much equipment in my life. I'm nervous. And I will say, just talk among yourselves for a minute because I'm going to FaceTime her in. I'm going to call the one on the right. Her name is Stella. Hey, Stella. You can say, he's doing. Oh, God, what's that?
Just in case you need it for anything.
I was going to say what I really need is a bathroom because I'm old. But, okay, we're FaceTiming her. If she answers, go crazy like I'm really special. Not special like, but special. Come on, Stella. Come on, Stella, you can answer. Okay. You know what I'm gonna stretch your hands out to her. Heavenly Father, at this present moment, my child who has a phone in her hand all the time, I've never seen her without a phone in her hand, even when she sleeps, goes to the bathroom, eats, and even goes to church while I preach all the time. I call her, Father, and she doesn't have that phone. So I ask right now you speak to her to pick it up and answer. Everybody says? Can someone explain how you can be a child and have your phone on all the time except when your father calls?
Hi.
How are you?
Good, how are
you? Oh. Where are you at?
I'm at the Optimist.
The Optimist, what are you eating?
Bread?
Oh, breads of the Lord. So I called you today and said, I'm not very talented. And you said, oh my God, Dad, what did you say? What did you actually say?
The most special, amazing talent.
Yeah, I have the most special, amazing talent in the world. Should I do it tonight?
I think they've got a
okay, so you think I should do it?
I think you can manage.
Okay, I love you. Tell everybody hello and goodbye. I love you. I don't care what your mother says about you. I love you. So, y'all want to see my talent? All right, talk among yourselves for a minute. Worship or something. And I'm going to get my talent set up, ready to go. Should I do my talent on the stage?
Yes.
The muscles I just possessed there are incredible. Thank you. Thank you. Give me that too.
This just in case you get sweaty.
Oh, thank you. You're a good man. Before I get started, I need you to pay attention because I'm feeling like you don't care. It's okay though, I'm old. I need you focused in because what I'm about to do, I don't do often, but to honor my two girls, Stella and Victoria Kate, who we call Lucy VK, Lucy Kate, she's got a bunch of names, multiple personality kid, but she's good. What I'm about to do, it's very special, it's meaningful to me. I don't think it rivals the guy painting, but he painted a lion in two songs. I'm going to give you one song, and I'm going to do my talent, so bear with me.
Wow. Wow. Wow.
Let me catch my breath. That's powerful.
Hold on. I'll talk. Okay. That's good.
I needed my inhaler. I don't think most people understand what that took.
Nope.
I don't do that everywhere. So if you took videos and you decide to post it and it goes viral, it ain't my fault.
You know, I trained similarly to him. And it's not easy.
It's not. Look at us.
Look at us.
Yes, this is not easy.
No.
No, it's not.
No.
Not easy.
Pastor, I had been in professional sports for 22, 23 years. I've seen a lot of things, and I can tell you that was a thing.
Do you think it's as good as dinosaur racing? Probably not.
Well, I would argue it's better because you got a donut.
That is true.
Marie, who was called from her mother's womb to be a dinosaur racer, did not get a donut, whereas you did.
Marie, that's a lie of Satan. Because when I went to Duncan, the Lord said, there'll be a dinosaur racer there. There, Marie. It's not a $50 Amazon card, honey, but it is a fresh from the grease chocolate Dunkin' donut. Enjoy it.
Sharing is caring. Pastor, if I may ask you, what kind of training have you been doing?
Can you put the next picture up there, if you will? I think this is it.
You have. Yeah.
I've been training since I was 11.
Me too.
That was the first time. Many of you don't remember the 1970s. That's why it's kind of a blurry picture. My dad took that because he said, what do you want to do with your life, son? Football. I said, no, Dad. Baseball, because my brother played both. No, Dad. Look at the legs. Basketball? No. Son, what do you want to do? I bowed my chest up. Dad, I want to be a professional donut eater.
Absolutely.
He took that picture. I've put it out there. That goes with me everywhere I go.
Everywhere.
To remind me, and I'll tell everybody here, you can achieve your dreams.
That's right. That's right.
Don't worry. Hey, this lie that says you have to have abs, look at that.
No.
You look at this kid here, you're not thinking, oh my God, I would lust after him. No, but he's going to be powerful.
Yep.
Amazing.
Yep.
And it's me.
Yep.
That's me.
I feel like that's someone you call if you need help moving, and everyone needs help moving.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So thank you again
for
being patient with me. Talk among yourselves as I come down there tonight, and I'll be there in just a minute.
I feel like you should give a round of applause. He really went out of his way to share a very special talent that he just said he doesn't just share anytime.
No, I don't do that at all.
Did you share it you were at a youth conference a few weeks ago. Did you share it with them?
No, this is the first time ever.
Think about it.
I've never done that. So thank you. Thank you, Billy. Give Billy a hand. Whew. Okay, let's pray and go home. Bow your heads, if you will. Close your eyes, if you will. I'm going to ask you a question. In your brain, I want you to go as far back as you can to the first memory that you possess. I'll give you a few minutes to think about that. In your mind, go back to the very first memory that your brain can pick up. All right, you can open your eyes. Somebody tell me your very first memory. What's your very first memory?
I don't know.
You don't know. You can't even remember.
No, because I'm thinking of something. I'm like 7 years old, so that's
not right. So you're 7 years old, but it's not right. But what was it at 7 years old?
No, like I.
What's your earliest memory?
I don't know.
You don't know either. Are y'all human?
No.
You're not a human. What's yours?
Getting my dog.
Getting your dog?
I like three.
At 3 years old. What was your dog's name? So we got a 3 year old memory. What's your memory?
Being in kids choir and leading right next to Pastor Nathan.
And how old were you?
I was like 7.
Dude, Nathan, you're her earliest memory. That is incredible. And she still serves Jesus. That's incredible. Yes.
My earliest memories was at my grandpa's house.
At your grandpa's house, what were y'all doing?
I burnt my hand off his wood stove.
Burnt your hand on his wood stove. That is awesome. I love it. Earliest memory.
When my brother hit my head off a log, it steals my head.
That is awesome. Your earliest memory is abuse. I love it. Yes. Come here.
Whenever I was at my grandma's house and her boyfriend and her broke up.
Oh, she was at her grandma's house and her boyfriend broke up.
Mine was, so when I was two.
Two?
Yeah.
Two?
I remember it like yesterday.
I remember the day I was born and a doctor spanked me. At two? Yeah. You can go, man, I want to touch your head. Ooh, it's hot.
So I was at my grandparents and I bit a hole through my lip and I needed stitches. Thank God I was okay. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. I have a scar.
You have a scar. Dude, that is awesome. Oh, you, yes. I love your hair, by the way.
Thank you. My earliest memory is dancing with my pap that passed away, sadly, in his living room.
Oh, how old were you?
I was like 3 or 4.
3 or 4, yes.
I remember one time I was sled riding and we were going down this big hill and I fell back and hit my head.
How old were you?
Three.
3 years old. All right, so earliest memory. Everybody, hey, I want to ask you something since you couldn't remember. What did you do yesterday?
I was just saying I can't even remember what I ate yesterday.
That is incredible. That's a gift. That is an absolute gift. I don't remember robbing that bank. No, that's an incredible gift. Like, you take a lie detector test and pass. Yeah, you were incredible worship. Like, I don't know how you know all those words. And you don't even, what's your name?
Yeah.
Good, see, you're doing good. Keep it up. There's hope. You could be a dinosaur racer one day. So let me do something. I want to put the next slide up for you. Because this is what I want to talk about tonight. And what I want to talk about tomorrow night. And it's choices. And I hope it helps you. I hope it changes you and inspires you and helps you be a better person. Here's the thinking. We're going to take tonight and tomorrow and pull it all together. So we'll keep going tomorrow. You're here tonight. How you look, how you dress, your weight, your hair, everything is a product of choices. When you came into the world, though, you were a product of somebody else's choices. So your very existence as a human being is a product of someone else's choices that didn't even ask your opinion. Nobody voted on whether or not you should come to planet Earth. Your parents didn't ask your permission, what kind of family you were born in, whether you were born into a home with no father, or born into a home that was poor, or born into a home and you were sick, or your mother or father died, or... The strange thing about becoming a human is you are the product of two other choices. Whether that's marriage and a mom and a dad got together and produced a child, whether it's rape, whether someone got pregnant by a lover and they left them and you got adopted, or you're a foster kid, or everybody in the room is a product of another human's choice. And nobody asked if you like that or not. Nobody asked what kind of family you wanted to be born into. Would you get to see your daddy? Would he work too much? Would he be an alcoholic? Would he be nice? Would he lose his temper? Would your mom and dad get along? Would you have enough money in your family to do the things you wanted to do? Or would you never get to do anything? Would you live in a good side of town and maybe have a swimming pool, or maybe not on a good side of town and maybe be poor? And nobody asked you. Nobody voted. You got shoved into planet Earth with a good luck. Hope you got a good family. And the strange thing about that, the first 2 years of your life, while you're alive, most people in this room don't even remember the first 2 years. Everything about your first 2 years of your life were all the product of someone else. What you ate, where you slept, what time you went to bed, what you wore, and your opinions didn't even matter unless you cried, and then it still may not matter. And by the time you get to age 5, psychology tells us that by age 5, 90% of your brain has already figured it all out. How to respond to life, to know what you can do, how to respond and interact with other people. By age 5, 90% of your brain's ability to be everything you're going to be by age 5 years old. And by the time you get into first grade, not only have your parents made all the choices for you, you get shoved into a school system and all the choices are made. What you will study, when you will take a test, science, math, algebra, whatever it is. And then by the time you're age 10, the majority of your life has been a life lived by everybody else's choices. And you learn to adapt to that by knowing what you can get away with and what you can do that will be approved or be punished. What you can get away with and hide and maybe do what you want to do, even though it's not approved by the people that are in charge of you, what I can do and get a pat on the back, or what I can do and get sent to my room and get punished. And then that's strange because everybody in the room has a different system of rewards and punishment based on the people that raised you and chose all these things for you. And now you're shoved into a generation, most of you at your age are starting to understand that you have this weird thing called a free will where you can make your own choices. And you can determine whether or not I want to make a choice and be punished for it, or maybe have a regret, or make a choice to be something and have everybody notice me. But about the time you hit age 11, 12, 13, you start this weird psychological thing that you have this ability to start reasoning within yourself to make your own choices. And not only that, you're shoved into 2024, where most people at your age group are already being shoved into a culture that tells you about gender identity. You can be a girl. No, I don't want to be a girl. I think I want to be a boy. No, I don't want to be a boy. I think I'm a girl. No, I think I'm a cat. I think I'm a dog. And everybody starts making all these choices because there's something strange about the power of being able to choose. It gives you this freedom that I'm really free. It's why you can find a teenager that gets so ticked off and starts screaming and says, I can't wait till I can move out of here. I can't wait till I can go to college. I can't wait till I can get out from under these roofs. Why? Because I want to make my own choices. I want to live and rise and fall to my own choices, whether it screws my life up or not. I want to be the one in charge of me. And then somebody comes along by the name of Rob or Nathan or Mark or Billy. And they say, well, let us make a choice for you. You need Jesus. You need to get Jesus in your heart. Why? Because if you don't get Jesus in your heart, you're probably going to go to hell and it's not going to be fun. And you need to serve God. And oh, we're going to make a choice. You need to read your Bible. And oh, we're going to make a choice for you that you need to come to this thing called holy disruption. And we're going to make a choice by what songs we got to sing and how loud we're going to go and how long we're going to go. We're going to start at 5 o'clock. Your whole world is nothing but choices. When you went today to the arcade, what games are you going to play? Are you going to do laser tag? Are you going to bowl? What are you going to eat? Cheese pizza? Pepperoni pizza? What kind of pizza are you going to eat? Who are you going to sit by? Where are you going to go? What are you going to dress like? Are you going to buy one of these t-shirts? How are you going to look? We're going swimming tomorrow, and they even make a choice. This is a t-shirt. If you're a girl, please don't show your belly. Wear a t-shirt. You come in the door. This is what you're going to eat, a hamburger hot dog. We hope you like it. Your entire life is laden with people making choices for you. And you have to be smart enough to go, what do I believe is real? What's true? Can I eat meat and lose weight? Can I just only eat meat? Well, what if I'm a keto? What if I'm vegetarian? Well, what if I'm this? Well, what if I do energy drinks? Oh, God, they could give you a heart attack. No, don't need energy. I'll just drink water. And then it's just everywhere you go, everywhere you are, you wake up. What time do you want to wake up? Your choices. Who are you going to snap? Are you going to leave the snap open? Are you going to leave them hanging? Are you going to answer the snap? How long is the streak? Oh, my God, I can't break the streak. The streak's been 4 years long. I can't break a streak. I got to keep the streak going. And everything are just choices upon choices upon choices that affect every area of your life. And what you have to learn, and what I felt like the Lord dropped in my heart when I told Nathan, I think I will come up, you know, because I don't really like to leave my family and my girls and my life. And so I'm very kind of thoughtful about where I will go. And I told Nathan, man, I love you. I'm coming to serve you. Whatever you want, I'll do, because I want to help you. I want to help Rob. And if some 60-year-old man can say something, I'll try my best. But what I do know, no matter what I say, I can try to convince you to come up and lay on the ground and cry. I can ask the praise team to come up and sing a song that is, if they even remotely sing the songs I like, I'm going to cry. Because there are certain songs that the moment they sing, I just sit in the back and I just start crying. Like, God, that song just touches me. And I did that this morning when they were singing. I was sitting back there just tears in my eyes listening to her sing. Like, oh my God, Jesus, this is, you know, in that moment, it's like your presence is in the room and all that's good. I mean, it's 59 years old. I'm still crying at girls leading me in worship. And I'm just like, this is incredible. But the moment they said amen and we have to go out the door, reality hits. The chill bumps are gone. The hair's not standing up anymore. The presence of God doesn't feel like he's here anymore. Reality strikes. I'm a 59-year-old man. It's hot outside. I'm sweating. I suddenly forgot the power of God because I feel like I'm dying here in this heat. Choices. What are you going to do with them? What are you going to do when you leave here? Just keep the shirt and go, wasn't that a great weekend? And the likelihood that people change long term is very rare. The goal of the weekend is not just go, God, what a great weekend. God so touched me. The goal is that it would shift you to understand the power to make a decision that can change you for the rest of your life. Not just now. And we all have to be smart enough to know that even though if I say to you, just believe in Jesus, give your heart to Jesus. We all, if we're just honest with each other, we all know people that gave their heart to Jesus, but they still got pregnant before marriage. The family still broke up. The father still left the mother. Like people that believe in Jesus, but they still make poor choices. So if you believe in Jesus and make poor choices, is it Jesus' fault? If you believe in Jesus and make poor choices, is it the devil's fault? Because we Christians are good to either blame the devil for bad stuff and really give God the thumb up for good stuff, when what I'm learning is Jesus has his life, the devil has his life, and in the middle is you, and you get to pick. You get to choose. Jesus is not going to beat you into serving him. He's not going to threaten you. He offers you his love and says, choose. And the devil at the same time, maybe the devil, maybe God. I just know we humans have this crazy ability to make good and bad choices. It's why one minute you're like, oh, I love Jesus. And the next minute you're like, oh, God, Jesus, forgive me. I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to do that. It's why one minute you can have a best friend and the next minute they're ghosting you because of choices. It's why you go, oh God, this is the love of my life. And 2 months later, he's hurt you with another girl and you're like, oh God, I hate him. I don't ever want to see him again. Choices. The choices that come from adults to young kids. Maybe a kid gets molested. Maybe a kid gets abused. Maybe a friend does something to another friend. And the reality of all of it are choices that, what do you want somebody else to make it for you? Because your whole life, we make it for you. Put your phone up or you're grounded. Get up and go to school. You better make an A. Don't, if you don't get a good grade, you're not playing on that sport team. Whatever we say. And then all of a sudden you hit an age where you realize, wait a minute, all of my training, all of the prayers, all of how I've been raised, all of what I've been told to do, don't cuss, don't drink, don't smoke, don't chew, don't do the wrong things, don't look at porn, don't do these bad things, don't lust, don't overeat, don't do. And all of a sudden we become 16, 17, 18, where we realize, oh my God, my brain is making choices. And you wake up and you realize on either side of the hand are choices that it can either be for yourself and for your own pleasure that may or may not turn out good, or choices for God to say, I don't care how I feel, I have to choose it. I'm the one that has to pick that. And as much as I would say to all of you, you cannot go wrong saying yes to Jesus. You just can't. It's the most amazing life, but we all know that we choose it. You choose it. And I came to just simply tell you that everybody in the room has to adult and realize choices are coming your way. And if you screw your life up, it might not be the devil's fault. It might be that nobody ever told you how to make good choices. You made choices that were emotional, choices that were stupid, as one of the best pieces of advice I ever got. Don't do stupid. Because sometimes it comes back to haunt you. Sometimes you make a choice to do things you shouldn't have done, and there's no going back because you wound up pregnant. Sometimes the choices are so bad that you wound up drunk driving and the person died. My cousin just died 2 weeks ago. Beautiful lady, 64 years old. Off of one choice, it's sad. It's just a sad testimony. We sent her home to Jesus. We had a wonderful memorial. But on Memorial Day, she got in her car. A simple choice. The choice is very simple. Just take a seatbelt and just click it. Who would ever think that could be the potential between a simple little choice? Has nothing to do with the devil. Has nothing to do with God. Just simple choices that can have profound impact. And she came out in the road and a car hit her. And because she didn't have a seatbelt, she's in heaven. It was their own statement. If she would have had a seatbelt, she probably wouldn't even went to the hospital. And you're like, what? What is that? My friend Jim in college, I saw him walking down the street and I stopped. I said, hey, Jim. And he said, yeah, Mark. I said, hey, it was a strange moment. I said, Jim, I want you to know Jesus loves you. And he looked at me. We were friends. He looked at me and goes, oh, yeah, man, whatever. And he just walked off. And 2 days later, Jim goes to a party, just like he always did. Jim always went to the party. He was the life of the party. Jim was cool. Jim was hip. But on this night, Jim just drank one too many. And on this night, Jim ended in eternity because he crashed his car. A choice. But then at the same time, we could go all day long with bad choices, all day long with choices that screw us over, all day long with choices watching Lifetimes and Netflix documentaries about people that do stupid things and Hollywood actors and viral videos and girls that did things they regretted, and we watch it and we see all the TikToks and all the, oh my God, look at all these stories of people's lives. But on the other side are stories of people that make good choices. People that looked at the hell and said, you know, instead of that, I think I want this. And it's not easy. It's not easy always to choose that which is good. It's not always easy to say, you know what, I think I am going to choose this way because it's going to be better for me in the end. And if I could tell you one thing tonight, if you could ever slow down enough to realize that every choice you make in life, slow down. And think about it. We even reading our Bible, I'm going to read my Bible. Okay, you made a choice to read the Bible, but take a choice to say, let me slow down and see if God speaks to me. In everything we do, choices. And the pressure that comes is incredible. The girls that pick the set list for us. I led worship for 17 plus years. The pressure that comes, I hope I pick the right song. I hope it goes well. Hope I remember the lyrics. The choices, just so that people can experience Jesus. But the pressure that comes, the pressure, I hope the mic's good. I hope I got everybody in my in-ear. I hope the lyrics are right. I hope everybody stays on a click track. The choices that come that override everything so much to the point that I can miss in the moment that there is a God that wants my life. I made a joke about it eating a donut, which I thought was dorky, but the donut was good. I could easily make a choice to go, I'm just not, like, I look back over my life and I always think, why would God pick me? Like, I know I have a special talent. I've never been to prison. I've never been a drug addict. Like, I have a little belly and a big forehead so big you could write music on it, and I don't know. But I know when I was 15 years old, I told somebody, I just want to do ministry. I just want to work in a church. And what that required me to do was make choices that were harder than just your average 15-year-old choice. Because when I hit 16 and 17, I was doing wrong things. And I thought, I don't need to do that. And I had to make hard choices. But the hard choices I made weren't because they felt good. It's because where I wanted to go and what I wanted to accomplish. Girls that led worship, incredible, absolutely incredible. Guys playing in the band, I couldn't see you in the back. I didn't know if you're male or female, but you're incredible. I texted my wife. I said, this band is incredible. I travel all around. This is an incredible group of young people. But guys in the band and that were singing, hear my heart. The choices you make are critical. Way beyond just how you sounded, your character matters, your prayer life matters, your attitude matters, like everything matters. My wife died, I was married young, I'll tell the story later on Sunday, but she died, got hit by a drunk driver in 1989, and I was a youth pastor. And I was ticked off, really. I mean, first off, I was mad at God. Like, I'm a youth pastor, and I'm serving you, and I'm working every day. And man, and I was getting ready for a youth camp, so I was designing the T-shirt, and I get a telephone call from the hospital. And when I got to the hospital, they told me that my wife was dead on the scene, hit by a drunk driver. And I'm thinking, God, why? Like, hook a brother up. Like, I'm down here on earth, and I'm serving you, and I'm praying, and I'm taking teenagers to the beach, and I preach to them, and I tell them you're good, and I tell them they should serve you, and I tell them they should trust you, and that's what you do to me? I was in my 20s. That's kind of how I felt. Like, that's how you treat me back? If anything, you should have kept my wife from getting killed by the drunk driver. Why her on a corner? Like, it was about a second and a half. If you could have just let her stay at the stop sign a little longer, left the house 3 minutes later, she would still be alive. But do you know what had to happen to get her on that curve at the exact moment the drunk driver was there? I don't even know how you could be real. I don't know how you could. And so I did that for about a day. Just hurt. And I remember feeling so guilty, like just awful, like I was a terrible husband. I can't tell her I'm sorry. I can't apologize. Like it's over. I went from see you later to never seeing her again. And just the thoughts, I didn't go home for 2 weeks because I didn't want to go back in the house. So however she left the house, I was gone for 2 weeks because I don't want to go home. I don't want to see her cereal bowl still out. I don't want to see her clothes out that she decided not to wear. And I just had this overwhelming guilt, like I'm an awful human, I'm terrible. And I just made a bargain with God. I just said, God, I don't know, but I know this. I'm a terrible human. I'm never gonna golf again. Because I would golf, I would play basketball, I would go to the gym. Like that was my life, just always go, go, go. And I tell God, I'm like, I'm never gonna golf again. I'm gonna sell my soul to you. And that was on a Saturday. She died on a Friday. On a Saturday, I had this prayer to God. God, as angry as I felt, God, I make a choice. I don't know what's going on, but I do want you to know. And I start crying. I don't want to cry. Because it was a choice that changed my life. And I'm grateful he helped me. So I said, I'm never going to golf again. I'm going to serve you. I'm gonna go do missions. I don't care about myself. I just care about you. And so that Sunday, 2 days later, we did this big memorial service. There was about 700 people in the room, a bunch of high school kids, and because we were really young. And another person in the car was my wife, the pastor's baby, and a friend. And the pastor's baby died as well. So we were doing a multiple memorial service with the pastor's baby and my wife. And we were talking about their life. And so the pastor of the pastor's baby came up to speak. I didn't even know him. He was from Florida. I was from South Georgia. Never met him. I'm sitting right here. What's your name? I'm sitting where Jana is sitting on the front row of the church. 700 people. And I'm just staring at the floor because I really don't care. I'm hurt. I'm lonely. I'm sad. I'm a little mad. I had the whole prayer to God, like, I'm never going to golf again. I'm going to go do missions. I'm going to serve you. And this pastor named Dale Brooks in the middle of 700 people. Jesus. He stops and he points. He says, Mark. And I'm not thinking me because I don't even know him. I'm just saying Mark. And I realize he's talking to me. Mark. And I look up at him and then I'm thinking, oh God, I wasn't even paying attention. And I just look at him and I just nod and he goes, Mark, the Lord told me to tell you to go golfing. And I'm thinking, what? This is the funeral of my wife. And I just told God yesterday I'm never going to golf again and never told anybody. And now some dude from Florida is telling me to go golfing? God, his words, God told me to tell you to go golfing. And in that moment, I don't know he's a magician or not, but I'm sure thinking, I don't know how he knows that except God. And the memorial ended, and me and my brother and my cousin grabbed our golf clubs, and I said, well, I guess I'm going to obey God. That doesn't even make sense. Who goes golfing on the day you bury your wife? That's stupid. But I got to obey God. And I made a choice. Golly, as dumb as it sounds, to grab a golf club, and I got to the first tee with a dead wife, mad at God, but made a deal with God, a choice as a 20-something-year-old man. And I put the tee in the ground, and I'm kind of thinking sort of with an attitude, like, okay, whatever, God, I'll show you. And I hit the golf ball, and when I did, it's like I could, like the presence of God I felt back there when she's singing is like the presence of God on a tee box. Like, that can't be right. Like, the presence of God in what it was and what I want you to know. Like, I'm trying not to cry. Like, I get old and I start crying a lot. Like, what I want you to know tonight is not a sermon. I want you to hear a 60-year-old man tell you that you can make choices when life is hard. And in that hard choice, if you choose God, you can know his presence. And man, there's nothing like it. In the middle of an abusive situation, or you made a dumb decision, then you just decide, God, man, I want to serve you. Show me you're real. And then all of a sudden in the middle of school, at a red light, in the middle of a field, at a sporting event, you're on second base, and all of a sudden the presence of God just comes and you realize that God is not just in this room. He's not just when the young people sing. He's there all the stinking time. And he just opens his arms to you and says, why don't you just make a choice for me? Make a choice for me on a tee box. Make a choice for me wherever you are, in the bathroom, in a car, in your backyard, at the swimming pool, at the beach. Make a choice for me more than you do for your phone, more than you do for your snap streak, more than you do for your TikTok like. Just make a choice, and wherever you make the choice, I'm going to be there. And so on that day in 1989, I told God this. I said, okay, all right, I'm not that good of a fella, God. I know my faults. I know where I'm weak. I said, but I'm going to tell you this. I'm going to make a choice. And my choice in 1989 is, as long as Mark Evans is alive, I'm going to read my Bible every single day. Come hell or high water, I will never live on planet Earth again that I don't read my Bible. That's my choice. I made that choice in 1989. Most of you probably weren't even born. And that was 35 years ago. With the death of my wife fresh in the ground, a mad kid in his 20s who just went golfing and thought, oh my God, the presence of God's on the golf course. Prayed a dumb prayer. I will never, ever live on planet Earth again that I don't read my Bible and try to know God greater than I've ever known him before. And I started reading my Bible every day in 1989. And last night in room 114 at my hotel, I laid down at about 12:02 a.m. I rolled over and got my Bible. And for my 12,782nd day straight, since 1989, 35 years as a 59-year-old man, I read my Bible again because I made a choice and never have missed one day since 1989. I didn't do it so I could preach a sermon. I didn't do it to be famous. I didn't do it to write a book. I didn't do it to win the Guinness Book of World Records. I did it because I realized one simple choice that you make for God can have profound life impact. And I can tell you the profound choice I made in 1989, as hurt as I am, as sad as I am, I'm going to live for you and read my Bible every day. I can tell you it's gotten me through four daughters. It's gotten me through marriage. It's gotten me through my wife when she had cancer because of a choice. I could be still mad and blame it on the devil. The devil killed my wife. I could be mad at God and go, I don't trust him. He's not worth serving. Why? Because everybody in every chair, it's up to you to make the choice. Live your life bitter, ticked off, and mad at everybody that's done you wrong. Or you can turn and say, you know what? I'm going to give my life to Jesus. And I don't care what it costs me, what choices I have to make. I want to show you another picture, and then I'll let you go home. You can throw it up if you will. I think the next one in line. That's my wife in high school. She looks kind of sweet and happy, huh? Next picture. That's my wife as a young girl. Again, sweet girl. Serves Jesus, married to me. Great woman of faith. But when she was born, her birth daddy got her mama pregnant, ditched town and left, and she never ever met her birth father. She was born to a mother who didn't have any money, who was doing best to make ends meet, who never met her birth father. At age 3, her second father came into her life and adopted her. And then at age 5, that father committed suicide on the phone while my wife heard the gunshot. Second father gone in her life. Third father here, her mother met him while he was in prison. He was in prison for aggravated robbery. And the third father raised her. You see, her third father got born again in prison. He was a Vietnam vet. He was an alcoholic. He robbed someone for like $12 and ended up in a federal prison. But in a federal prison, he makes a choice for Jesus. Her mother makes a choice for Jesus. She had been abused as a child. She had been molested as a kid. Her baby daddy ran off and left her with nothing. Her second husband committed suicide while he was on the phone with her. But she made a decision for Jesus. And Robin's third father made a decision in prison for Jesus. And they met. And they begin to raise Robin to know Jesus. To not make excuses about your life. To not become a victim because you don't know your earthly dad. To not become a victim because your second father killed himself. They raised her to follow Jesus. And that picture I showed you, if you'll go back one if you don't mind. That picture there was my wife in the 11th grade as the captain of the cheerleading team. But it became so difficult to serve Jesus because the high school she was in, that she made a decision in the 11th grade to leave and to go to another school an hour and a half away. So can you imagine your senior year of high school? Every friend you've ever had, you make a decision to leave and drive an hour and about 12 minutes to another school. Just so you could be in a place where you could know God, where you could capture him, where you could make a choice for Jesus. She ends up going to a Christian university in Tulsa, Oklahoma. She makes a decision for Jesus to go to this Christian university. My wife dies May 19, 1989. I'm sitting at a red light. I'm reading my Bible, still a little upset. Why my wife? I hear a voice. You're going to go to Oral Roberts University in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I'm thinking, why? I just graduated college. I don't need to go back, do I? You're going to go to grad school. I want you to move out to Tulsa, Oklahoma. And I'm like, wait a minute. I've got a full-time job. I have a house. I can't do that. No, you're going to go to Tulsa. Okay, I'm going to go to Tulsa. And everybody's like, what are you doing? Why are you quitting your job? Why are you going to Tulsa? What? I don't know. You don't know anybody out there. No, I don't know anybody. I don't even have any money. I don't have a job. I just know I'm supposed to go to Tulsa. And I guess God's going to take care of me. I go to Tulsa, Oklahoma. And lo and behold, I get to Tulsa, Oklahoma and meet her. And lo and behold, two human beings get together. And lo and behold, the two human beings get together, fall in love. Two broken people who are following Jesus, two hurt people that are following Jesus, two broken people that could be victims that decide to follow Jesus. And now, 35 years later, four beautiful girls, two son-in-law, two grandbabies, two dogs that are like humans, and an incredible life, because rather than becoming victims and being bitter and ticked off, mad at the world, blaming everybody else, two human beings made a choice to just trust Jesus even when it's hard and I don't want to and I don't feel like it and I would rather scroll all night than read my Bible. I would rather keep my snap streak live and going than to blow it and go read my Bible or go to church or sing or worship. I would rather get rid of all of my playlists and just worship because I can't make those choices. Bow your heads. I cannot choose that for you. Statistically, I would love to say all of you would choose it. All of you in the room would choose Jesus. But statistically, it's almost defeating when you just look at the real stats of how many people really serve Jesus their whole life. Like get married, still serving Jesus. Get out of college, still serving Jesus. Go to high school, they serve Jesus. Like the statistics are astounding toward the negative. Toward how many people fake it, how many people say they're a Christian, but their choices don't add up, how many people act like they're born, they sing the songs, tear off the roof, the king's in the house, they sing the right songs, they smile when they're supposed to smile, they come to the youth conferences, but after it's all over, they don't make the choice, that I'm going to be the person that just like loves Jesus, and even when it's hard, I'm going to choose him. And even when I don't read my Bible, I'm going to do it anyway. And even when I have to say no to some things that I want to say yes to, and even when I have to run from some friendships that I don't want to run from, I'm going to choose to do the hard things because in the end, the things that I choose for Jesus pay off. I will say this, I know to be true. I've never met an old person that chose Jesus that regretted it. Never. But I've met a lot of old people who didn't. Who go, God, I have so many regrets. So I'm not going to scare you into life. I just want to encourage you that if you could hear one thing tonight, that you would hear your choices matter greatly. Your choices matter greatly. And the profound truth is how many things influence our choice. Friends, popularity, easy, lust, happy. Profound things influence where the group's going, what my friends are doing. And there's no way a parent or me or Rob or Nathan or Billy or Allie, or anybody can follow you around 24/7 and make choices for you. We can guide you, help you. We can tell you there'll be rewards and punishment, but at the end of the day, you're smart enough to know that no adult can be with you 24/7 all the time. You know good and well you can delete things and hide things and you know, have separate accounts and things that you can move around and shift around that nobody knows. And we all know that's true. People do it all the time. So all I'm saying is, whatever choices you're making tonight, just be adult enough to ask, are they good ones? Or are they going to hurt you emotionally? Are they going to cause you to have regrets? Or were you an adult and go, God, I need to change some things? So with your eyes closed, like pray this prayer. Heavenly Father, are there choices I'm making that need to change toward you, toward the better? And just like I asked you in the beginning, what's your earliest memory? And we thought about it, and everybody started raising their hand. I can tell you. Well, now I'm not asking your earliest memory. I'm asking your latest choices. If I ask you the latest choice you made last week, would you raise your hand and be proud of that? If I ask, what was your latest bad choice you made? Would you raise your hand and go, I want to tell you my last bad choice I made? Because that's not the norm. The norm is to make the choices and then hide them. Hopefully we make good ones or bad ones, and we don't get caught if they're bad, and we get praised if they're good. But what was the last choice you made? What were the last 10 choices you made? If you had a column to the left that said kind of poor choices and a column to the right that said pretty doggone good choices, and I just ask you to go over the last 2 weeks of your life, the choices you made of who you're texting, the kind of pictures you're sending, what you're scrolling, what you're looking at, what you're liking, what your conversations are, what you're talking about in the night hours, what you're listening to, if just those things, not even thinking about the devil, not thinking about hell, not thinking about whether God loves you or doesn't love you and all of that, we can get into just a column of choices that probably could put a smile on God's face and choices that maybe not. And the last 2 weeks, if you just started writing them down and you were honest with yourself, you don't even have to show them to anybody. If you just went home tonight, you texted yourself and you texted that column. Here's a column on the left. It's kind of, oh man, I probably shouldn't have done that. And then a column on the right. Okay, I did good here. And then sit down. And then tonight before you go to bed, since this is kind of a holy disruption, maybe before you go to bed, you go, God, how about disrupting some of these bad choices maybe that I've made? How about helping me stop them? And then these things, I'm going to teach you kind of how to walk through that tomorrow. But tonight is just about, would you understand the power of your choices? And as you become an adult, it won't be your parents' fault. It won't be God or the devil's fault. It'll be what you chose to either trust the Lord or run after yourself. Chose to say, I'll pursue you, or I'm going to pursue me. And it's just up to you. And God puts people around you to say, hey, I've ran me. It's not too fun in the end. And puts people in front of you that says, oh, I was running me, and then I turned to Jesus. And he gives us wonderful worship to think about him and wonderful leaders to hear about him. But at the end of the day, when the songs are over and the leaders have gone home and you're by yourself in your bed, it's just you, it's your phone, it's your social, and you're just there. And your brain is in overdrive and you're thinking, you may not even like yourself. You may not like the way you look, or the choices, how your hair looks. I have freckles. I don't. I hate my hair. I hate my body. I love my friends. I don't like them. And the brain is kicking in overdrive and the choices are all around you. I pray that you would always hear, let the meditations of my heart be to him. With your eyes closed, I want you to listen to a scripture in Hebrews chapter 12. Maybe when you go home tonight, or maybe your friends, if you're hanging out together and you're staying together, maybe when you go home tonight, you could pull this verse up. This is what it says in Hebrews 12, 1. Why don't you look up there with me since it's on the screen? It says, therefore, since we are surrounded by a huge crowd of witnesses. And what that means is that there's a group of people that all made the right choice. It's critical to get with some people that'll make the same choice you make. It's critical to get with people that are going where you want to go. Because I do know this about humans, we get in crowds that think like we think. And this verse says a crowd of witnesses. So what it means is a crowd of people that all chose God, a crowd of people that were all running after God. This is what it says about him. It says a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith. Let us strip off every weight that slows us down. That phrase right there, the third line in the middle, I want you to really get it in your heart, because oftentimes the thing that weighs us down are the choices we're making. And then it says, and the sin that easily trips us up. And if we're not careful as Christians, we think sin, okay, what? And we try to categorize, well, what is sin? What's bad sin, good sin? Versus just your choices can be tripping you up. So bow your head one more time. I'll let you go. Is there a choices you're making that are tripping your faith? Are there choices you make that are tripping up your faith? Then tonight when you go to bed, just Heavenly Father, Jesus, I choose you. And it might be hard. It might be some, you got to let go of some things. You got to tell some friends, I just can't hang out anymore. It's not always easy, but I'm going to make the choice. So Heavenly Father, tonight, to every young person in the room, every adult, all of us, I think it's clear we're all product of choices. Good and bad. And I pray we become a product of faith and not failure. I pray we look back and go, I remember when I made a decision and a choice, and I've never backed out on it. So young people, not just holy disruption for this weekend, how about for the rest of your life? God, disrupt my life anytime you need, because I'm here for you. Whatever you want, whatever you want out of me, I'm here. But every day I wake up, I'm going to choose you. Every day I wake up, I'm going to choose the things that would put a smile on God's face. I'll teach you that tomorrow. So, Father, thank you. Now, if you're here tonight, just quickly, and you know, okay, I got some choices that I probably aren't very good, but tonight I'm at least going to stand up and go, yep, that's me, and I'm going to do my best by standing to say I'm going to make some choices that change, kind of like I did with the Bible. I don't know if I altogether knew what I was doing, but I at least made a decision. So if you're willing tonight to say, I'm willing to make a decision to start making choices for Jesus rather than just me, stand up, and I want to bless you before you go. I want to start making choices for Jesus and not just me. So Heavenly Father, tonight, these precious young people, I lay my hands on them. I bless you, mighty man of Jesus. You'll not be a product of the world. You will be a product of the Lord Jesus and His presence and His power. And He will go before you. Don't get discouraged. He'll go before you. He'll make ways when there doesn't seem to be a way. He'll open doors when things don't seem to work. He'll, at every step along the way, you feel yourself getting frustrated. Stop, take a breath and go, I want to remember this weekend. I want to remember that some man told me that I could stop and I could choose the Lord. And when I would choose the Lord, He would, the Bible says, if He's for me, who could be against me? All, every step along the way, choose Him when you wake up, when you go to bed. You'll be an old man and you'll look back over your years and you'll say, let me tell you what the Lord has done for me. Father, I bless sweet Jen. I bless her life. Use her in profound ways. Her choices for you tonight when she stands up. I just feel this. I don't like to say, thus saith the Lord. I'll just say it's me and what I feel in my heart for you. I touched you on the head, and when I did, I felt in my heart to say this to you. Tell her when she opens her mouth to sing, her choice to sing about me is that I'm going to choose to flow my healing through her. and your choice to let Him use you to sing, He is going to choose, as words come out of your mouth, they're going to be like a healing to people. You may never know it. Some may come up and say, while you were singing, let me tell you what happened. Write it down and judge it. But I felt like when people have headaches, they'll run to the cabin, take a Tylenol, take an Advil. Like I kind of see that, like your mouth is like a medicine bottle. And when you open it up and begin to sing, as your life begins to age and as you get older, it's going to be like a medicine. It's not, and I hope you hear this, it's like your singing is not going to be music, it's going to be medicine. I don't know if you write music, I don't know what, I don't know if you write lyrics, but I see you sitting down and you're jotting down ideas and you're jotting phrases down and you're writing things. And it's because it's like God's going to give you prescriptions. And it won't be, don't get frustrated if it's not a full song. Like I need choruses and bridges and all of that. Like just write down the prescription, one line, two lines, and then those one or two lines, they'll be like medicine. Like God knows what His kids need to hear. It's going to use you profoundly in Jesus' name. Come on, everybody stand up with me if you will. Give Jesus a shout of thanks and praise. Come on, give Him a good shout of praise. And my closing words are, if you hear nothing, make choices for Jesus. They pay off. Pastor Rob, give Pastor Rob a hand as he comes. I love you all. I'll see you tomorrow morning. I'll see you tomorrow night. I love you dearly.
Wasn't that incredible? So powerful. I can't wait to hear part two tomorrow. I can't wait to hear part two of what the Lord has laid on Pastor Mark's heart for tomorrow night. It's going to be incredible. But I thank you all for being here tonight. I thank you for making the choice to be here, be present, and allow God to be that holy disruption for you for this weekend. But just as Pastor Mark was saying, like, don't let this just be one day, one weekend, one moment that we just walk through and we leave unchanged. Let it be the holy disruption that echoes through the days of your life, not just of, oh, I'm different, but echoes through your pursuit of Jesus. We don't just pick up a book. We know it's the Bible, but we don't pick up the Bible just to check the box. But we pick up the Bible to know the author. We don't just sing songs because that's what you do at church and that's what my parents raised me to do, but I sing songs because I want to pursue the heart of Jesus. That I don't go into my bed at night and talk to my ceiling with no expectation, but I lay down for the night and I reach out to Jesus and I know that I'm having a conversation, and as I'm having that conversation, I expect Him to respond. Allow what God wants to do through this weekend, because Pastor Mark's amazing. He's a servant of God. Cody Sable, amazing servant of God. You all here, if you've trusted Jesus with your life and made Him the Lord of your life, you're a servant of God. You're a son, you're a daughter. And He wants to do incredible things through your life. So I encourage you, come back tomorrow. And this isn't just, you know, for you guys. Like, I'm excited to come back tomorrow. I'm excited to come back and see what God wants to do in our time together. Because He's good and He is able to do more than what you could ask, think, or imagine. So let's step into that tomorrow together. I pray you guys are blessed. I'm blessed. I'm out of words, but my heart's full. I get you guys. I'm not sorry, but if you guys could bow your heads Father, Lord, we just thank you, God, for what you've done today. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity, Father, to just set this time apart for you, to just encounter you and just to pursue you, to make the choice to be here, to see clearly in your word that we are cheered on by the witnesses who have went before us, people who have made the choices for you, the choices to serve you, the heroes of the faith, and that we look to for inspiration, and we look to and we say we want to be like them, but we want to be like Jesus and we want to be like you. So we thank you for that example, but we thank you that you didn't just leave us with your amazing word, but you left us with Holy Spirit. You sent us Holy Spirit because it would be better. So we thank you for your presence. We thank you, God, for your love. As we go, Father, I pray a blessing over the students, the leaders here tonight, the speakers, the pastors. Pray, Father, that you protect them in their going out and in their coming in tomorrow. And Father, we come expecting to encounter your goodness and to experience your love in a greater way. Father, we thank you, we love you. Amen.